This morning is Vision Sunday, and if you've been here, you know it has been our practice. We go through books of the Bible, and today is going to be different in that we are going to really cast the vision for where we believe the Lord is leading us to go in the near future. And what I want to do today is try to paint a picture. How did we get here? How did the leaders get here? And so you can see, this is where we believe God has called us to. Now, over 10 years ago, I became the senior pastor here. And I remember feeling way, way, way over my head. Because here I am coming to shepherd a flock of people, knowing that I have to give an account for your souls. And I have taken that responsibility really very seriously. And early on, I remember when I looked at the passage when Solomon became the leader, and I remember he said in 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verse 8, and Solomon said to God, "Give me now wisdom and knowledge to lead your people." And that has been my prayer for 10 years. If someone asks me, what can I pray for you about? I always say, pray for wisdom, because I need wisdom. How do you lead? How do you go about doing what God has called me to do as the shepherd of his flock here, and how do I lead the church? Now, as I started being the senior pastor, and I would talk to other pastors and go to conferences, all the time I would hear people say to me, you need to be the leader, you need to cast the vision for the church. And I would have people come up and they would say, so where do you want the church to be in 5 years? What is your 5-year vision? What is your 10-year vision? And I'm a shepherd. I'm a pastor. I'm not a visionary. I'm just, you know, that's the reality of how God has gifted me. And so I would say, well, in 5-10 years, I just want to be faithful to Jesus. You know, that would be a good thing. Not blow the church up, that would be a good thing. You know, let's faithfully walk with the Lord. And yet, the more I learned and the more I understood that God called me, that we do have to have a vision. We do need to go forward. If churches do not go forward, then they die. And I remember just getting on my knees and crying out to God and saying, God, I'm a pastor. I'm a shepherd. I don't want to say I'm good, but I'm good at going to the hospital and visiting people. I'm good at sharing the gospel. I'm good at meeting with people. But I don't even think 5 years down the road. And I remember just sitting down with a couple pastors and older gentlemen and picking their brains, and they said, lighten up, man. They said, don't worry. You have people. God will bring leaders around you to help you. And so I just began to pray about that, and the reality is it's true. God has gifted us with elders and staff and deacons, and we work together as a leadership team. And so early on, I started to take the leaders through different books on leadership. Part of that was for me. So we went through books like Top 10 Mistakes Leaders Make, and there's a quote in there. Even if your organization is 50 to 100 years old, new times require fresh expressions of the group's passion. And that's a good thing. We are about the gospel. We are about preaching God's word, but we need to have a fresh expression of what God has called us to. We went through Henry Blackaby's book on spiritual leadership, and he said that vision can serve as the North Star for organizations, helping keep their bearings as they move people forward. If people are not moving forward, if they're not growing, if they're not going towards what God has called them to do, they're going to be in trouble. And it is true. Even in our own spiritual lives, if you are not actively swimming against the current of this world, the world will take you back. And that is true as a church. And so over these last several years, I have endeavored to get a leadership team where consisting of deacons, elder staff, where we go forward, where we have the same passion, the same vision. We can't be going this way or that way. We got to do what God has called us to do. And over these last few years, we've worked together very well. We do retreats where we get away and we pray and we say, Lord, what do you have for us? What are we called to do? How do we How do we make things more effective? How do we do that? We have spent a lot of time in prayer, a lot of time on our knees saying, Lord, we need your help. Because here's what we realize. Churches close every day. Matter of fact, depending on the stats you read, conservatively, 9 churches close every day. And you know why that they close? Is because the leaders don't have a vision. They are not going forward for God's glory. And so we have sought the Lord. We have looked to see, okay, what have you called us to do? And it's very interesting, as we have done that, and I look back at the history of this church has always had leaders who have been visionaries. They have been leaders. They have always thought down the road. And so there's many of you that are new here. I want to give you a quick church history of how we got to the place of where we are today. Not many of you may know this, but this church goes back to 1897. It was the third German-American Baptist church. And there were 82 people who started that. Now, if you do the math, if the church started in 1896, guess how old we are? We're 116 years old. And it's interesting. I read a quote by John Maxwell. Listen to this quote. It's a great quote. It says, "Who we are today is the result of choices we made yesterday. Tomorrow, we will become what we choose today. To change means to choose change." And it's true. I mean, it is absolutely true. You make a choice to change, and that will it will impact what happens in the future. That does not mean that theology changes. The gospel definitely does not change. The Bible does not change. But the way we operate, the way we do things, often does. And that has been the church's history. In 1913, they moved, and they became Newland Avenue Baptist Church. And 2 years later, it quickly outgrew that facility, and they became Burns Avenue Baptist Church. And so they had embraced change. The leaders back then embraced change. They knew you had to keep going forward. You had to keep going forward. The church was made up of mostly German immigrants. And so people would come in, families would come in, and guess where they would go? They would go to the German church, the German Baptist church. And so that's what they were. The church conducted itself in the German language until 1930. So if you came in 1929 and the pastor got up to preach, it was in German. But in 1930, they made a big decision, and that decision was to switch over to English. And that was a big change. There were 47 people who left, and I don't know, no one's still around who talks about that history from 1930, but I got to believe that was a cranky time, because it's like, what do you mean? We're German people. What are you doing changing our language? And yet they looked to the future. They said, we have to think of the future and of the gospel and spreading the gospel in where we are at. And so they went forward. And they did it. They changed that name. They didn't change their theology. They didn't change the gospel. They went forward. This church has always, in one sense, been forward-thinking. In 1938, they had a radio program on CKLW that went, it's called Echoes of Heaven. It went to 1966. And then as the church grew after World War II, the people began to move out to this area, and the leaders began to pray, what are we going to do? And so they ended up selling the property. They bought this property in 1954. They laid the groundwork. They laid the cornerstone. They sacrificed. They said, you know what? We want to impact people with the gospel in the Grosse Pointe area. And on Easter Sunday, 1955, they had their first service. And the place was packed, and people came out. And when they built this facility, they built it really to be state-of-the-art. If you read their dedication book, it talks about the lighting downstairs and how beautiful it is, and they talked about all the things. And in reality, it was so forward-thinking. Matter of fact, to this day, there's a sign right outside here that if you look really closely, it was a fallout shelter. I mean, downstairs, It was a fallout shelter, and I can't help but think that have been a great gospel opportunity. You know, Russians start throwing bombs. You know, down there you're sharing the gospel with people. Needless to say, when they made this place, here's what they had in their brochure, their prayer of dedication book. It says, "We have made this facility." To make it one of the most attractive places of worship in the Middle West. That was their goal, and that's what they did. And by the way, this place was. It was state-of-the-art. It was attractive. It was a beautiful, beautiful facility. And all along, they knew, we recognize that this edifice is of value to thee only as it encloses the temple, a body of people who remain true to thee. And so, really, as we're only good, I mean, you can have beautiful structures, but if we are not giving glory to God and we are not living for his glory, it means nothing. There are cathedrals that are out there where there is no gospel, and it's not good. And so safe to say that from 1955 to 2013, a lot in the world has changed, has it not? I mean, think about it. This world has changed massively. Back in the day, the church was mostly made up of families. I talked to some of our people, and it's like, oh, yeah, you never talked about anybody because you're talking about Cousin Fred. I mean, you didn't go there. No one, I mean, everybody was related. And I was even told that when I came 10 years ago. It's like, there's a lot of related people. They said, look for the blinking middle eye. And I said, okay. But back then, it depended. If you would go to a church, if you were Presbyterian, you'd go to a Presbyterian church. If you're Catholic, you'd go to Catholic church. If you're Lutheran, you go to a Lutheran church. If you're Baptist, you'd go to a Baptist church. And that's how it was. You went where you were. Guess what? That is not the case anymore. Do you realize that? Things have totally changed. Matter of fact, as a church, the leadership team realized that. And as a church, you realized that. And 2 years ago, we made the move to change the name from Grosse Pointe Baptist Church to Cross Point Christian Church. And I want to share a testimony with you that I have heard dozens of times, and here it is.
Good morning, my name is Antoinette Rue, and about a year and a half ago, me and my family were church shopping. I was raised Catholic and wanted to expose my children to God and the church. In coming to Cross Point, we felt instantly at home. Over our time here, me and my husband Brandon have come to accept Jesus as our Savior, and we will be baptized on November 24th. Coming from our background, if the name of the church was Grosse Pointe Baptist, we would have never come through those doors. We say thank you for making that change, and we look forward to growing with Cross Pointe.
It was a hard change that we made, but I'm telling you, I have heard that story dozens of times. And God has opened the door for the gospel. Why? Because the world, it has changed. So here we are now in 2013, and we look around and we have a 58-year-old building, which we need to fix up. We started back in 2007. If you recall, it was very much like this. I preached a message on where we think we're going to go and some things we needed to fix up, and then we had a meeting, of which very similar, we're having one at the beginning of November to approve the accepting and the projects and the funds, and we went forward. And if you recall at that time, just let me give you a little flashback. These were our bathrooms, you know, and this is what it looks like now. And so there were things that we changed. We knocked two holes in the wall into the chapel there, and that gathering space outside there now is the number one used space in this building. Why? Because the leaders had a vision to say, you know what? We need to get better at what we do, and so they went forward and they did that. We did as much painting as we could with the money that we had. We laid as much carpeting as we could, but now we run out of money. Back in 2011, we started and looked at a facility master plan, and we invested some money in that, and we looked to say, if we're going to do ministry in the future here in this community, if we're going to reach it, what are the things that we need to change? We need to look at the integrity of the building. We need to look at things that need to be updated. And so we did that. We got the report back. Many in the congregation, if you took the time, we had congregational visioning sessions where you could come and give your input. Many of you did that. And so we got the input on these things, and there was a master plan put together. And the leaders prayed about it, and we said, we need to make some major renovations here. But from 2011 to 2013, it was not the time. Earlier this year, though, we got together on one of our retreats. We got away, and we were praying, and we felt as a leadership team that now is the time to do it. Now is the time to go forward. And we hired a capital campaign consultant. We actually to do a feasibility study, and many of you took the time to fill out a survey, and some of you met with Clark, and we decided, okay, we're going to do this. How much money can we raise? If we're going to fix this place up, what can we do responsibly without going to the bank and taking a loan? We're not going to take a loan from the bank. We're going to raise the money here. How are we going to do that as we maintain our weekly needs? We have to be responsible. And so we did this feasibility study, and what came back is we are able to do a certain amount. So phase one that we're going to give to you is something that we can do. I got to be very careful. We can't do anything. God can do it. But I will just say this, the leaders are being responsible in coming before you. And we're not putting this gazillion-dollar thing out there and saying, okay, we can do this when it's difficult to do. And so after much prayer and thought, we have come forward with our campaign logo, which is a heart for God's house. And there's double meaning to that, of which you will, as you will hear as time goes on. So there are three phases to this. The first one, and I want to talk about, is phase one. There are three components within phase one. And the first is that we are going to renovate the sanctuary. That was when we got your input on different things. That was one of the things that came to the top. It was the most attractive place of worship back in 1958. And now it does. It needs a total makeover. None of you in your house, unless it's an antique, but you don't have things the way they were in 1958. You don't. You just don't. So what are we going to change? Let me just run through some things. The sound booth, which technology has changed. That that is going to change. The flooring, which includes the carpet that has holes in spots, and the tile, that is going to be covered and changed. The walls are going to be repaired, and the ceiling are going to be repaired, and they're going to be painted. The stained glass is going to be sealed, and the limestone is going to be cleaned, because I understand when a rain comes in from this direction, there's water over there, and that's not a good thing, so I've told. The lighting, we are going to not only replace the lighting here, so it's fully adjustable, it'll be nice, but also throughout the whole building, we are going to change the lighting and put in energy-efficient lighting. The good news is we are going to donate these to Wayne County Jail, the one that are in the hallway. So, you know, it's going to go, to good use. Probably going to get a couple emails on that one. But and then finally, what we're going to do is we're going to replace and respace the seating, the things that you're sitting on. They're out of code, way too close together. If you sit on that side or on that side, there's little mushroom-type things. Those are not foot stands. Those are air returns. We are going to have to rework some of the air ducts. And the reality is the seating is not only, from what you have told me, massively uncomfortable. I get to preach every week, so I don't have to sit in there. But it is worn out in more places than you think, and it is in disrepair. 21 of these pews right here have cracks. Some of them are small, some of them are bigger, and some of them, ladies, their dresses get snagged and pants get ripped, and so it is time to be replaced. Now, the leaders did a lot of research and study and hours and hours and hours of meetings and talking about things and looking at things, and we have come up with what we believe is the best answer, and that is we are going to put in a seating from series seating called the Vera 35, and it has pew ends, so we're gonna maintain the structure of how it looks. But the beautiful thing about this, right now, if I had everyone stand and I said, Victoria, please come forward, I want to pray for you, what would have to happen is everyone would have to, you'd have to file out and Victoria would come on down. When we do this, basically the seats fold up, and so with people, not only when someone comes in late will they be able to sit down, but you will be able to, I could do an altar call and have people come forward for prayer and not have it be something that is bad. And so as we go forward in this, and by the way, I have talked to several different churches. David Jeremiah's church has this has those seats, and they said, you will not regret getting those. We got a great warranty on it, and we believe that it is, it will be a good thing. And we realize, you know, you say, why do we do this? You know, well, when we come into this room, we do. We come to worship an infinitely holy God as a congregation. And believe it or not, there are people in this church who have fibromyalgia, arthritis, they have all kinds of back problems, and people are in pain as they sit here. And that's not right. We should fix that up. There is a sense in which we do this as you would your own house. For most of you, if you go to your house, you do what you can to fix it up so it's welcoming to guests. And all we're saying is we want to do that, especially in this room where it is the first impression that people walk into. I realize there are some who would be happy to sit on a beanbag. I know I've had one, and you know what? And I love that spirit. Having said that, we generally in our houses, if you invite people over, you don't have beanbags that they sit on. You have them have a nice table. So that's one part of phase one. I'm going to have Pastor Jason come forward, and he is going to talk about the second part of phase one.
I want to read to you from Psalm 78 to start. Psalm 78 says this, "Give ear, O my people, to my teaching, and incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings from of old, things that we have heard and known that our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, but tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders of what he has done." One of the great opportunities that we have in this capital campaign is to do this for the children of this church community, to communicate to them some of the glorious deeds of what God has done in and through this church community in the past, what he is doing now, and what he is going to do. I, as a person who works with the children and the students, I am excited to see the opportunity that our children will have to understand what sacrifice is, to learn about what generosity is, to see what stewardship is as it is lived out in the lives of their parents and of the adults of this church. A number of years ago, our church adopted what is called our strategic vision. And our strategic vision is to reach the families of the community through effective children and student ministries. This vision really reflected a commitment that our church has had for years. When we were preparing for this, Pastor Matt pulled out all of these old historical documents along with Sue Kruger, and we were looking through things. When this building was dedicated in the 50s, this church employed a pastoral assistant. And one of the duties of that pastoral assistant was to assist and direct the children's ministry and the student ministry of this church. In the 1950s, almost no churches had the forward thinking to look and say, we want to care for our students, care for the young people of our community and congregation so much that we are going to employ someone to come and do that. But this church was thinking of that. Our Awana program is known throughout the community and has been for many years. It is common when we will have adults come back and say, I went to Vacation Bible School there. I went to Awana at Grosse Pointe Baptist Church, at Cross Point Christian Church. I know what you do for children, what you do for students. I have had many anecdotal conversations with people. I met with one person once who we were talking about a specific student who was a part of our church, and they had had a poor experience at their previous place and, in fact, were not allowed back. And so I was talking with the lady, and she said, well, you know, you guys over there, you take anyone. And I remember thinking, that yes, we do. I'm thankful they take me. All right, we take anyone. Our doors are not closed to people who are difficult. Our ministry is not closed to children that have needs. We have had another example just this week or last week. My wife and I are walking down the street, and we met a neighbor. We just moved, so we met a new neighbor, and she said, oh, I know of your church. That's the one with all those kids programs. Yes, we are known in the community. People frequently say, I went to VBS there. I went to Awana there. They remember people. And so this church has always had this kind of vision. And now part of what we're doing is putting that into practice. Last year, or really 2 years ago, I began to express to the elders that I felt that I needed to move out of student ministry. It wasn't that I didn't like the students. I do. I love them. In fact, I miss them. I told them last week, I miss you all. And they got a little sad. I said, I'm not going to cry about it, but I do. I miss being down there. I miss being with you. But I realized that they needed a new voice, that they needed to hear from someone who had better things for them to hear than I was trying to give to them, and they needed something new, and I didn't have the passion that I once did. And I shared that with the elders and shared that with them as if to say, if you're telling me I need to leave, I will go, you know, because I understand that coming and saying, listen, I want to stay here, but I don't want to do what I'm doing, is a little presumptuous. But I did express to them that I love this church, that I feel a call not necessarily just to a student ministry, I feel a call to a church, and I love this place. And so over the past year, we've made a tough choice, a difficult choice as a church family to add staff. I've moved into a different position where I preach here half of the time, and I'm very grateful for that opportunity. Pastor Matt has been wonderful in letting me do that. You all have smiled at me and laughed on occasion and patted me on the back. Whether that's genuine or not, we don't know. We'll know in heaven one day, and I assume by then it won't matter. But I've moved into a new position. In the weeks that I'm not preaching, it's not like I sit in my office and twiddle my thumbs and count my books, you know, and start to read. We have brought together a fantastic children and student ministries team that I have the privilege and the blessing to oversee. We have Nathaniel King, who is a fantastic director of student ministries. We have Renee Aldridge, who's directing our children's ministry and does a fantastic job. And we have Kayla Clark, who is the administrator of our children's ministry. And we come together every other week and we talk about what's going on here. We talk about your families. We talk about ways in which we can be ministering to you, ways in which we can do things. And so to that end, we've developed this team of leaders. We've recruited people who are passionate about kids. We're asking our church family now to back up this strategic vision to care for the children and the students of this church with strategic giving. One part of this capital campaign will deal with including work on the parts of the building that children and students use on Sundays, on Wednesdays, on Monday nights, on Friday nights, and throughout the year. You know, at one point, as Pastor Matt alluded to, our basement was state of the art. It was state of the art, but those times are done. And it's time to make the basement more inviting, to bring it up to date for the ministry needs of today. You can see that in a lot of the rooms and things that we have downstairs, there's work that needs to be done. We've started by renaming the basement. I know it doesn't sound like much, but changing a name to something sometimes has a great effect on what's going on down there. Some children refer to the basement in general as the dungeon. That doesn't work well when we have visitors. You know, where do the children go? The dungeon. Don't go down. Just send them down the stairs. You don't want to go. And so we've called it the Grove. And some people, when we talked about that last week, they kind of chuckled. Oh, that's silly. That's funny. Look at that, the Grove. But there's a thought behind this. A grove is where things grow, where things are planted and grow to maturity. That's what we want. We want our children in student ministry to be a program, be a part of your kid's life that equips families so that children will grow in Christ from cradle to the dorm. We want to do that. And to that end, we would love to have a space that communicates that and communicates that children and students are important to our church, because I think what happens sometimes is when people end up in the basement, they don't get the picture of the heart of this church. Sometimes they see the messed up tile. They see the lights that don't always work. They walk into certain rooms and there is a smell. It's not anything that we've done purposefully. It's a part of the building. One of the biggest areas that requires attention is the fellowship hall. In doing the feasibility study, we came to the understanding that a multi-purpose facility is not possible. We would have loved to have built a huge building with a gym and all sorts of things, but it appears as though that's not where we're at as a church family, and that's okay. That might not be what God has for us right now. But what we will need to do then is rethink the space that we have to fit the needs of children and students while also making it usable for large-scale events and for dinners. This is a picture, a video that looped through of where our middle school is meeting right now, or in next hour. They will be meeting in Sunday school down there. Now you can see that it's kind of walled off by movable partitions, that the kids sit on hard wooden chairs, and that it's dark, it's kind of dank. People walk through it all of the time. This is where we put our middle school. And when newcomers are here, or even when our regular people are here, in a sense, it kind of communicates that, listen, you're in middle school. This is what we think about middle school. All right? You can just be here. You're in an awkward state of life, so we're going to put you in the most awkward room that we have. We realize that it's difficult for you to learn. We realize that for some of them, specifically, it's even more difficult to learn because not everyone learns the same way. It's very difficult for a kid to be stuck in a room like that with lighting that kind of works and hearing things all over the place, and then to listen to dedicated teachers who are trying to communicate the truths of the gospel. We need to do something about that. Our children's ministry downstairs on a Sunday is growing to the point where we're not just going to need to fix that room, we're going to need something else. We have groups that if you go down there, there are godly people who are being tested every week by 20 to 30 young children in their humility and in their patience. And we have not had an incident yet, praise the Lord, where any adult has lost their mind. All right? But part of it is because of spacing. We're going to need to give them more space. We're going to need to rethink some of those areas. Sometimes it tells a kid that we don't value them enough to develop the space they're in into something more inviting. We want to do that. We want them to understand that they are valued, that we care about them. I'm very, very excited about what the future holds. I'm excited about what is happening downstairs right now, what will be happening second hour. In early December, you're going to see children put on a performance up here. God's doing something. God's really working in the families of this church, and I'm excited to be a part of it. But I would ask that we not hide from the children and the students of the community, that we're passionate. That we're passionate about their development as young men and women committed to Christ, and that the words of Psalm 78, where the psalmist says, we will not hide from their children, but tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders of what he has done. I pray for us that we will continue to do that in these ministries. But also, as a part of this commitment, keep in mind, we're not talking about paint on a wall. We're talking about hopefully changed lives that will in the end bring glory to the Lord, that will bring glory to God, so that in years to come, people will still talk about what happens here with the kids, how we care for children, and how that has become a legacy of this church to God's glory. Thanks.
So that's the second part of phase one. And then the third part, when we opened up the chapel there, we essentially lost a Sunday school room, a life group room, and so the goal is, there are two rooms that are down the hallway that are currently used by our nursery school, Grosse Pointe Nursery School, and what we want to do is transform those into life group Sunday school spaces, and then upstairs we have an apartment above the offices, and that would be renovated. There's bathrooms there, so we could put some of the nursery school classes up there. And then the final part of phase one will be to put we'll have the nursery school down in that whole place, but we do need to have a security system for the nursery school, which includes locked doors with keyed entry and card entry and surveillance cameras. What every other school has, we currently do not have at all, and that is a great need. So that will be, all of that what we just talked about is phase one, and Dale's going to talk a little bit about what the price tag on that puppy is in a couple minutes. Phase two is not as elaborate. In one sense, it's somewhat simple. This is our entrance by the office, where the green awning is, and Lord willing, we will be able to put an elevator there. Now, we have talked about putting an elevator in this place for years. There's actually a reserve fund. There's $18,000 that are there, and people have said, well, why do you need it? I mean, yes, there's funerals, and yes, there's buck dinners, and yes, there's certain events that you would need it to go downstairs. But as we make these adjustments, that elevator will get used multiple times every day, because the nursery school, the elevator will go up to the nursery school wing, and the steps for the little kids, because we have to bring a smaller class up there, the steps are daunting. And so with that elevator, it will be able to be used every day. And the reality is there are people that need it. We have had times with buck dinners and different things where we've literally, four guys grabbed each end of a chair and we've carried someone downstairs. And so this is something that has been a long time talked about, but that is something that we feel the Lord has called us to do. And then phase three, which is, we will not do any of that unless we have met all of phase one, and then we do phase two. But phase three would be projects like exterior improvements, landscape, sealing the parking lot, digital controls for the organ, and those are the parts that will be in phase three. And we recognize we do this that we could do ministry more effective, that people who come through the doors will feel at home. And I know this is a big thing, and historically we as a church have embraced change, not for the sake of change, but it's about people, and we will never lose sight of that. It is about people and people's souls that we care about, and so we are excited as we go forward. At this time, I'm going to ask Dale if he would come forward. Dale and Nicole are our campaign coordinators, and Dale is going to give us some information, and then we're going to partake of the Lord's table.
Thank you, Pastor. Then the people rejoiced, for with a whole heart they had offered freely to the Lord. Our campaign scripture describes the culmination of the sacrifice, the financial sacrifice, that the people of Israel and David made as they built the temple. And it seems odd to give you a campaign scripture that describes the culmination of our event, but I know that this can be the culmination of our capital campaign as well. But there is a condition, there is a requirement. The people of Israel experienced so much joy because they took their very hearts and they laid them on the altar of God. If we will do the same, I'm confident that at the end of this campaign, we will experience this type of palpable joy. Our mission is to build God's house. When we say God's house, yes, in one sense, we mean this building. This building is dedicated to God. It's His, it belongs to Him, and it's for His use and His glory. But we don't just mean this structure. When we say God's house, we hearken back again to 1 Chronicles. David said, I had it in my heart to build a house. But God said to David, I will build you a house. God was not referring to a structure, but rather to a heritage that culminated in the birth of Christ, the reason for our hope and salvation. So God's house is built on the salvation of souls. Our mission is to build God's house one heart at a time as people come into this structure and accept Christ as their Savior. We do have a reason for joy already, even before our campaign has begun. You may have noticed in your campaign bulletin that we were considering a special business meeting next week to borrow funds from the Endowment Trust to pay the capital campaign consultant. Individuals have stepped forward and sacrificed financially already. Those funds have been met. And so we have joy today, even before we get started, that we can cancel that meeting because people are stepping forward to sacrifice with their whole heart. Because there is a financial element to the capital campaign, you'll hear three principles or three truths repeated often throughout the next 6 weeks. Number one, God is the owner of all. The psalmist says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. If God is the owner, that must mean that we're not. We're not owners, we're stewards, and that's principle number two. And then finally, God has blessed us indeed, and we are blessed to be a blessing to others, our third principle. Pastor mentioned that there are three phases to our financial goals and projects for the improvement of our facilities. Phase one that he talked about, the project and goal is $795,000. Phase two, including the elevator, the project and goal is $300,000. There is a phase three that if we meet the first two phases, it will cover items like ceiling and resurfacing the parking lot, a new circle drive for the front entrance of the building, and other items which will be listed on a capital campaign brochure, and you will receive that this week in the mail. If you want to mark down important dates, begin to mark down today, because as we kick this campaign off today, you do have a project today. As you leave from here, you will see in the narthex, there are booklets entitled A 40-Day Journey to a More Generous Life. Each one of those booklets has your name printed on the back of it. Just like our offering envelopes, would you please pick that up today and begin to read it today? As the title suggests, it's a devotional booklet. It's meant to be done daily. And over the course of the next 6 weeks, we would like you to read each day the devotions contained within that booklet. For those that are not present this morning, those booklets will be mailed out tomorrow morning. But if you're here today, please pick that up before you go home. Begin to read it so that we all might better understand God's teaching in the area of stewardship. Next week, October 13th, all life groups will meet in the lounge. If there's overflow, they will meet in the library. But please be aware, starting next week, all life groups will meet in the lounge. If you attend the 9:30 service, your 11 o'clock life group will be in the lounge. If you attend the 11 o'clock service, your 9:30 life group will be in the lounge. On November 4th, there will be a congregational meeting, and the purpose is to approve the budget and expenditures for the capital improvements, as will be outlined in the brochure. Please mark November 4th on your calendar. Finally, on November 17th, each family or individual will be asked to make a confidential 3-year financial commitment. Your decision to participate and to what extent is between you and the Lord. Between now and November 17th, you will receive a lot of information and you will have the opportunity to ask all the questions that you may have. But right now is when this campaign starts. And I would like you to begin by asking two questions today. When you go home, I want you to ask God two questions. God, will you show me where my heart is? Is my heart where you want it to be? And number two, God, if my heart is not where you want it, will you change it? Two questions I want you to ask God today. Right now, I'd like to pray corporately for us all. And let us all ask God these questions of ourselves. Our gracious God, we look with expectancy to the joy which can be ours. But we see the pattern through your word that this joy comes from sacrifice, from sacrificing our hearts. And so as a body right now, Lord, we are one in Christ and we ask you, will you show us where our heart is? Lord, we confess that as your fallen creatures, our hearts may be distant from you, may not be where you want our hearts to be. So we also ask of you, Lord, if our heart is not where you want it, will you please change our collective hearts? We give you the glory for this time we have to worship you. Amen.